So this is the second reading for the first case bundle called IT Doesn't Matter by Nicholas G. Carr. Okay, so this document talks about a very basic idea. The idea is that because IT or information technology in general, which basically includes hardware, software, systems, protocols, you name it, basically technology as we define it, has become very common to the point that the strength or the advantage that you could get from it is now going away. It doesn't give you a strategic advantage. Refer to the idea of the VRIO resource model, which was the value resource model, where we talked about whether a resource is valuable, it's rare, it's inimitable, and your organization is organized to make advantage of it. So keeping that in mind, IT is no longer something that is rare. It isn't something that is inimitable. And if you were to use the VRIN model, where N stands for non-substitutability, it is no longer non-substitutable either. So it doesn't give you an advantage. This is a bare minimum. So thinking that you have certain levels of IT services available, some kind of investment being made, and assuming that that would give you some kind of a leverage or advantage in the industry, you're dead wrong. Because IT has become a commodity. Now, this is a bare essential that everyone has. This is like saying that if you have an office, your business would somehow be successful. It's just as lame as that. So the same way that you could not think of having an office as an advantage compared to your rivals, you should not now think of IT as an added advantage. What you should be thinking along is how exactly that particular technology, that particular IT infrastructure, or that amount of data that's available to you through those IT technologies can be used. That will give you the real actual advantage. So it talks about several examples, and you can go through those examples, but in short, what it talks about is this concept. So it talks about how it's vanishing advantage. So whenever technologies were made available, say if you were to look at the earliest technologies that are now common, you can look at the internet. Now, when the internet started rolling out, people were making comparisons. They were like, okay, this is going to be amazing. This is going to change everything. Yes, it did. In the beginning, it did. But then as time went by, several companies went on board. They got on board on the internet, and then it vanished. So when a resource becomes, there's a quotation in between, it says, when a resource becomes essential to competition, but inconsequential to strategy, the risks it creates become more important than the advantages it provides. What does that mean? That means that if there is any resource, whether it's technology or anything else, it is, if it becomes a necessity for the competition to even begin. I mean, you would not be considered a company in this day and age if you do not have an e-commerce presence. Especially if you're a technology oriented company. Even if you're not selling online, you need to have an e-commerce page. If for nothing else, for corporate, image building. If you don't have that, nobody takes you seriously. So it is now essential to competition, but it has no impact on your strategy. It's inconsequential. It doesn't drive your strategy. It's not like saying, oh, if you have big data today, that will make you a better suited to a particular environment, because then it will become part of your strategy. Big data is not an advantage that everyone has. Some companies might have it, some might not. So in that scenario, if you do not have that particular resource available, then it creates a huge risk. It doesn't give you an advantage, but it creates a risk. Think of it as the same idea as the hygiene theory, where the idea was that there are some factors, that's a theory we learned in HR, that there are some minimum factors that are necessary for a person to do some work, some job. I mean, a person needs to have a chair to sit on, they need enough cooling in the room to work on, they need the right tools to work on. Those are not motivating factors. Those are bare minimum hygiene factors. The motivational factor would be like the job title you have, the enrichment that you get. Those will improve the chances of you working harder. So it's very similar to that same concept. So technologies, as they become more common, the advantages that you get out of this becomes vague. Now, there's a distinction that needs to be made between two kinds of technologies. There are proprietary technologies, which could also be referred to as infrastructural technologies. Proprietary technologies can either be owned by one company only, which means that they have some kind of patent or control over it. The example given is of a patent of a pharmaceutical company. So only they can use it. Or they could be another form, which is known as infrastructural technologies, which offer far more value when shared than in isolation. Imagine if you're talking about infrastructure technologies like the internet. If you're the only one that has access to the internet, it's useless. If you're the only one that has access to digital marketing platforms, it's useless. If you're the only company that has access to social media, it's useless, because who else is there? So infrastructural technologies are the ones that give you advantage only if other people use it. The analogy or example that they've given is railroads. In the 19th century, railroads were a major technological revolution. If you are the only company that owned the lines between suppliers and factories and all, it'll be useless. But because other people also use it, because other companies also use it, your own suppliers use it, you at the end get the advantage. So this is important to understand that proprietary technology and infrastructure technologies are two distinct things. So infrastructure technologies can, in the beginning, when infrastructure technologies are being developed, they tend to be proprietary in nature. For instance, when we talk about the internet, earlier on there were only a handful of companies working on it. So they were proprietary technologies. Let's take artificial intelligence and algorithms being built for helping artificial intelligence learn. Only a handful of companies working on it. IBM, Google, Amazon. Earlier on, those were proprietary technologies. But as time went by, the advantages that are drawn out of this would only be useful if it became an infrastructural technology. Now Google lets its machine learning algorithms be available to other people for development. Say, take another example. The operating systems Android and iOS. In the beginning, they were proprietary projects by each of their companies, by Google and Apple. Later on, they allowed other developers to develop stuff for it. If they didn't, we wouldn't have millions and millions of apps available on the iOS store and the Google Play store, right? So this is how it works. Now, moving on, it talks about several such examples, so I'll skip that. The loads and loads of examples that are discussing the same thing over and over again with reference to different industries. There's also another heading on page number 5, which says the commoditization of IT. So as time goes by, unlike other technologies, IT has all the hallmarks of being an infrastructure technology. That's what it says, which means that it's an infrastructural technology. It's not a proprietary thing, because it's designed to give advantages, because it gives to everyone. That's how the internet works. That's how all the protocols work. Everything else that IT provides us works in the same way. So similar to how power grids and would provide us electricity or the transportation system, the same is true for IT. However, say for instance, it gives the example of micro mini computers and local area networks, Ethernets, extranets. Networks themselves are also IT technologies, which are infrastructural. What is the point of having an extranet if you're not letting your supplier connect with you? That's the whole point of it. What is the point of having a database when you're not letting your supplier access it? What is the point of a customer relationship system if you're not collecting data from customers and from external sources and using that to make your predictions? Similarly, IT also, so as time has went by, there's a lot more standardization that has happened in it, which has made it more homogenized for its usage, which means now it's become more common. And now, for most business applications, the benefits of customization wouldn't really happen. I mean, if any company tried to take a IT technology and tried to make it very customized for themselves, it will become useless. Say, example, if I were to create a website that could only be opened up by a specialized browser using some specialized protocols, no customer would be able to land on my website. So I have to make it more standardized so that it's more accessible to more people. If Facebook were to create a technology where only a handful of people with a very specific kind of hardware or software could access Facebook, it would become useless. I have to make it more standardized so that other people. That does not mean that I'm giving away my business secrets. That just means I'm making it more accessible, because that is where the advantages come in. If you take Facebook's example, it is precisely because of that that people show up there, put up content there, and advertisers come in there to show up their ads. Then content creators create more content there, and we go and we read it and we share it. That's how Facebook generates its advantages. So the advantages comes because it has become an infrastructural technology, because it has become standardized, not because it's customized. Another aspect of IT is that it is replicable. It is very hard to imagine a commodity than the byte of data, which is like something that's easily available. So IT is very replicable, which means that it cannot be used for any business advantage. Everybody can have it. Anybody can go out and buy a couple of pieces of hardware or get any software available or get an alternative for it. So it's no longer going to give you advantage. Plus, the advent of the internet has made the commoditization of IT even more possible, meaning now everybody can have access to it. A person sitting in a third world country has the same access to data that someone in the first world country does. The whole idea of the internet was to make it easy for everyone to have access to the same resources. Each one of us can access Google's Data Studio and get Kaggle and get the same data sets for our artificial intelligence projects. So these web services where people are charging money for different services are accessible to everyone. I can access Amazon's computers and make up my calculations. I can access and pay for Google's servers and do my programming using cloud storage or using cloud computing. Anybody can do that. So it's not like if I can't afford it, then I can't use it. I can. So that's also another advantage, or rather a concept that we need to understand. It also talks about the fact that there's a concept called the Moore's Law, which was given by Gordon Moore, who was also the co-founder of Intel, if I remember. So basically he said that the processing power is doubled every 18 to 24 months and the price is half. And that is true. This basically means that the speed with which IT is actually becoming common and how cheap it becomes is much more accessible. Plus, because of the internet, because of cloud computing, it's accessible to everybody. So that's another advantage that's happened. So it's no surprise that these characteristics, that IT evolution has actually mirrored the same infrastructural idea. So the World Wide Web is another example, where because it is standardized and because it allows more people to put up websites on it, there is no real advantage anymore and everybody has access to it. So as with any, with earlier infrastructure technology, IT has provided more forward-looking companies more opportunities to build upon it. They can still own proprietary technologies that will work with IT. So as I've always said, imagine if you have the right amount of data, even though you're using the same databases, the same ways to collect the data, the way that you use that data will give you advantages. So we look at Google search. Google search has the same business plan or business model as Yahoo or as Bing. But we all know that Google search is probably the most superior search engine we've ever had. Why? Because they are making better use of that data. Their machine learning algorithms are superior. Their access to that information is superior. They have the same access to the same kind of information that any other search engine does. But the way that they make use of it, the way that they recommend stuff to us in the search results is far superior to that of any other search engine. Right? So that's how they're making, using it in a better manner. So there are several more examples. There's a diagram that actually shows the sprint to commoditization, where it compares different technologies such as railways and how long it took the railway to actually become commoditized compared to electric power, compared to IT. Now, if you look at the graphs, the number of users of IT increase at a far more exponential rate as compared to electric power or railways. So it is because of the fact that IT in its very nature is like that, which is why this is happening. Opportunities for gaining IT based advantages are going away. But big time, and that's also because of another reason. Because best practices, we've been talking about it already, best practices are built into software these days. ERPs are designed with best practices. So how would you differentiate a company that's using SAP ERP and another company that's also using SAP ERP? It's the way that each company actually makes use of the data available to both of them. They both have the same data, they both have the exact same software, they both have the exact same business processes running through those software. It's what they do with that information that differentiates each one. It's what they do with the strategies is what they will do with each other, with respect to the market. So while no one can actually precisely say when the build out of an infrastructure technology has concluded, there are many signs that the IT build out is much closer to its end than its beginning. Meaning the availability or the ending of IT becoming absolutely common and absolutely commoditized is already there. It's already available. So it's already there. So all of these companies are trying to achieve advantages out of these IT related technologies. Then it talks about from offense to defense. So what should companies do? So from a practical point of view, they should learn a lesson from infrastructure technologies, which is that when a resource becomes essential to competition, which is something I quoted earlier, that's where it is. When it becomes essential to competition but inconsequential to strategy, the risk it creates becomes more important than the advantages it provides. So think of electricity. That's what the example it gives. No company builds its business strategy around electricity usage, but it's a bare minimum. But if it gets shut down, your business collapses completely. This is how powerful IT is. It is a bare essential. It's that hygiene factor. You don't have it, your company goes down the drain. You have it and you assume that it will give you some advantage, you're dead wrong. It won't. It is a bare minimum. So there are some new rules of IT management that it lists down, which is, with opportunities for gaining strategic advantage from IT rapidly disappearing, what should companies do? They should spend less. They should spend lesser on IT investments that does not give them anything. Since the commoditization of IT has happened, spending on needlessly on IT makes no sense. Follow, don't lead. Use the Moore's Law. They say that the longer that you wait to make an IT purchase, the more you will get for your money. So wait for the technology to become more matured and then buy it only when you need it. But there are some cases that sometimes you may want to buy it earlier. Sometimes. Focus on vulnerabilities, not opportunities. Very interesting statement. It's very unusual for a company to get an advantage through using some already mature technology. But even like a small disruption of the availability of that technology can disrupt stuff. So corporations need to understand that if you want your IT systems to be available all the time, if you can't handle it, give it to some other vendor. And that's where the outsourcing concept comes along. So if your business, if your core business is not technology management, and if you can't do it better, give it to somebody else. If you're an Apple company, you can't manage your softwares, your databases on your own, give it to some vendor. Let them handle it. Focus on something else. If you believe that you're a bank and handling the security is not your cup of tea, give it to a security firm so they can keep an eye over it, instead of putting in your resources into something that you can't really possibly do as well, right? So that's, I think, pretty much it. So the last statement I say, the studies of corporate IT spending consistently show that greater expenditures rarely translate into superior financial results. In fact, the opposite is true. So stop believing that throwing money at the problem will solve your problems. It won't. You need to only spend money on IT expenditure if it makes sense. If you think that spending more on IT infrastructure will somehow make you better, you are absolutely wrong. So that's pretty much it.